Walter's painting comes from somewhere different. It comes from a very corrupt kind of space, a very wise kind of space. It's about the landscape as it's been fucked up.
Well, let me put it bluntly, I think that Walter was born 100 years too late. I think that he would have been a great artist maybe 100 years ago, but I really can't take that sort of work seriously today. I can't.
Well, it's fantastic that somebody was able to paint South African landscape and actually get the light and just like the heat and the sound and everything of that landscape correct.
In art history specifically, as well as in literary studies, there's been a whole revolution in interpretation of landscape over the last two or three decades. And I think the land as such is such an important entity at this present time in South Africa's history, because it's a way of forging and forming identities, political and personal collective identities.
Well, I suppose the thing about landscape is that it's never a neutral value. It's never about just what you see. You're always reading a whole lot into it.
I think a lot of people, foreign people, won't actually understand what he's trying to capture, because it's the sound of like a landscape and a smell and a very, very specific light. So I think it's just sort of like a light that's affected by like heat.
You know, you get wildlife artists, landscape artists. I think he's got a different... He creates a different veneer over his work and his ideas, even although he doesn't know that he's doing that. But I'm actually darn sure he does. Maybe he feels guilty about it, that's why he doesn't want to talk about it. Because he knows exactly what he is in fact doing. You never really know with Walter.
He moved to the landscape, out of the city, which of course was at one time a very popular theme of his, the idea of abandoned buildings or lonely buildings, isolated in an urban environment. He moved through that, through the small town environment, and then into the flat, open, apparently barren, obviously unpeopled wilderness.
I always just wanted to get away out of the city and so on, everything and so on. I just enjoy living out here, or you know, away from all that hustle and bustle. Maybe someday something good will happen.
The people are very nice in this town. I mean, they very no. Generous people, kind people. I suppose they must think you're a little bit strange or whatever. Maybe, of course we don't have a, I mean, I haven't, sometimes, some people, maybe they think I haven't got a job or something, unemployed.
Well, we each have our separate garden because we've got different gardening styles. And he likes straight paths with plants. Oh, tumbling over, and he overwaters his plants because he worries about it too much. He's actually quite a nurturing person. He's like always feeding the children and worrying about them. We both love gardening, and it's like a spiritual discipline, because we don't go to church and that, because we feel like we don't belong there. But I think gardening is one way of learning about God. It teaches you a lot about life. It's the same in the way that if you don't water the things, they die. If you don't give them attention.
He not only through the style of his painting, which is particularly at odds with current fashion, he isolates himself more and more from the current cultural or artistic community. I think he does that for a number of reasons. He does it, I think, because he is impatient with their dialogue, because he's not somebody prone to dialogue and discourse or theory.
I don't think he's regressing. I think that he's stating the obvious. I think that he is not dealing with the present. He's avoiding the fact that art not has developed, but that art has changed.
I mean, I remember my first encounter one of Walter's paintings. I've got a sense of having seen that picture 1,000 times, like driving through the Karoo. It's that snapshot that you think, fuck, if only I could paint that, you know? It's that moment of recognition of a landscape. And I was very impressed with that, the way that he'd hooked into some sort of memory.
It's the same stuff as Pienaar. Even though Pienaar was a more structured, ordered interpretation of Afrikaner nationalism, Walter Meyer is, after the fact, looking at it from a much more sentimental point of view, like if only we could go back to a point where things made sense in the world. A nostalgia for a past where you didn't have fences around your houses, you didn't have to lock your doors, you didn't have to worry about being raped, murdered, mugged, or coming home and everything's missing. But the flip side of that is that was very much, we know, a product of apartheid. And wanting to turn back that clock is wanting to go back into the golden years of apartheid, which I cannot accept.
Well, trust the very dull critics that we have in South Africa to immediately say that Walter's like the new PNF. But the thing about PNF that he was, at that point it was, the English were controlling the show, the Afrikaans intelligentsia had to form a nationalism. And got a lot of poets and a lot of artists involved to form an identity, which PNF was very much part of. And the big landscapes that were made were made to say, there's some quotes by PNF about the land belonging to the white man, being given to by God, which is an obscene statement. Whereas Walter isn't doing that at all. Walter's just painting the landscape and the buildings in the landscape that have been made by maybe even this very ideology.
Walter's work for me is very definitely retreating from that whole ideology. It's almost giving us the closure of that ideology, an answer to Pienaar's works. Walter is painting in the 1990s in a so-called new South Africa, is painting the platteland as it has become. He's very much debunking that whole myth of the idealized landscape of ownership to the land.
I don't see any social comment in them. I think that like me and like a lot of people who in fact written about this, he just takes pleasure in ruins and simply likes these places. There's something melancholy, something poetic. I think that people like to feel that what they like is for reasons far more serious and deep than simply liking a depiction of some place that they find somehow interesting.
I think it's easier to paint man-made things, you know, because you're painting something somebody has made before or has changed before. I mean that, but it's very difficult, I think, to paint just organic things.
People think it's nothing for him to just churn out a few paintings, but they don't realize how he, I don't know why he has to, but he's always anguishing about his painting. If he's wasting his time, you know, why can't he get it right to paint the sky like it looks? Or drie kwart van die tyd vroeg hy oor sy skilderkunste.
You know, this blue, because this blue is so overpowering, I mean, it's, you know, it's just as important as the landscape itself. You know, that's maybe what's so problematic about it. I mean, if not stronger, it's luminous, you know, I mean, it's sort of vibrating. There's real brightness about it, but at the same time, there's a sort of a, also a flatness.
Nowadays, he paints quite a lot of straight landscapes, and that's a much riskier kind of project in a lot of ways. To simply paint the landscape without any kind of clues to the human occupancy of that landscape. And simply try and project the human values through the way that you paint leaves and trees and things like that. It's much more oblique. How successful he's being is another question. I mean, personally, I find that the most powerful of his paintings are the ones that include the human presence via a house, a wall, sometimes a broken down truck, something that cues you into a particular way of reading the painting.
Ek voel ek het die tema nou al bietjie oor, jy weet, over, I've overdone it almost. I've done it too many times. I mean, maybe, and I'm not traveling, you know, as much anymore. And I mean, I don't want to go and look, you know, search for things to paint. So I just want to sort of work with the things around me.
I think it's in his immediate environment that he finds his inspiration, like right outside his, like outside of his clothes.
There's an interesting idea put forward by a Chinese philosopher Chang Tzu. He says something to the effect that man needs no more than the space that he's standing on. If everything else becomes unsolid, and the only solid thing left is the small area of space under your feet, how long can you use that area of space? Now, in Walter's case, of course, you could imagine him using it forever. I think one of the reasons why his landscapes are so compelling and so successful is because he uses that space under his feet so well, because they're not purely retinal, they're not simply about nature's beauty, they're about a kind of beauty in the mind, a sense in which sensation, mind, soul, body are all somehow locked in together, so that the character of the painting is a reflection of the actual character of the landscape.
Painted one tree. No, I think a landscape reflects a kind of emotion in a way. I mean, like this windy day today. I mean, it. Yeah, as soon as you paint things, you start to look at things in a different manner. I mean, it really becomes like a adventure almost. In a way, I mean, a day like this, which is, I mean, to most people wouldn't think it's a dreary day or so, but by painting it, you understand it better or something. Looks like Simon Stone. Do you know his pictures? But I like his paintings.
Which other contemporary South African artists do you like?
Contemporaries? I don't like these conceptual things, conceptual art. Ugh, maybe I don't understand it or something. I probably don't understand it. Or I can't, I can't have a, okay, I don't know how to relate to it or what to make of it. I just like the more traditional sort of art. I'm just trying to paint in a traditional sort of a manner. And it's difficult enough, I think.
He's, in a lot of ways, outside of the sort of manufactured history of late 20th century art, the sort of progress of styles and the movement towards some kind of presumed millennium. It's a very honest kind of process. It's basically him and his subject matter. And I think this is often very threatening to a lot of his peers, who many of whom can't actually pull that kind of thing off to start off with.
When we're living in a media-saturated society full of things to look at, whether it's television, whether it's neon signs, advertising, it's the age of the spectacle. Guy Debord, Society of the Spectacle, is now here, everywhere we look. Now, that has to come into your work. That has to influence what you are as an artist. But he's not doing that. He's reinforcing that subject by romanticizing it.
But if you render just a landscape like it is, you know, I mean, that could also, I mean, it could be nice, you know, to look at.